Hello, welcome to Jason the Old Millennial. My name is Jason, speaking to you here in my basement in the great state of Kansas. Today's video, I am going to be finishing up, showing off all my Blu-rays and DVDs that I own, all the movies I own. I've been going through them alphabetically, so I'm at the end, recovering T through Z, so the last chunk. Of course, as you know, once you get to the end of the alphabet, you usually don't own as many movies in that part of the I have those letters anyway, so you don't get as many titles. So it's a good place to finish the series, kind of just showing off what movies I absolutely love and why I love them a little bit. Just give a little bit about each one. So so we're gonna start with the T's here. First, I got a Disney movie called Tangled. I got the DVD version, and then, again, sometimes I have trouble finding the Blu-rays or for a good price on Amazon, so I get the DVDs unfortunately. So love to get the Blu-ray at some point, but one of my favorite Disney movies and animation movies of all time. Absolutely love it. Was really blown away by it. I remember when it came out, I was kind of like, felt like Disney was kind of not doing very good work at that point. Like, and they weren't doing a lot of musicals, animation musicals. So I was kind of down on Disney at the time. So I didn't see this in the theater, but I caught it. I think I rented it maybe or something. And man, I was like, wow, I wish I would have saw it in this theater. This was so amazing. It was absolutely hilarious. I love the characters. Love Eugene, or the Flynn Rider character. Absolutely hilarious. Here comes the Smolder, you know. I love that. And the music was absolutely amazing, especially the See the Light. That whole sequence is one of the best sequences ever in animation, I think. And it's an amazing duet song. They're singing it. There's everything's being lit by these lanterns. They're on the water. I mean, just a beautiful animated scene, and the music is amazing. But yeah, I love a good Disney animation musical, and Tangled was really one that really started off, I feel like, a new almost renaissance of animation musicals, starting with this, and then Frozen, Moana, Coco, or Coco might have been Pixar, but then you got Encanto recently. So I hope they keep doing more musicals. I don't feel like they've done it the last couple of times, and they've been kind of done movies lately, so I hope they go back to doing some more musicals, because I love that. Next we got Taken. Kind of started its own genre, I feel like, of older actors that are like in their 50s and above doing action movies, and it's kind of been amazing. I mean, of course, my favorite is the John Wick series. I absolutely love the John Wick series. And even you can go with Tom Cruise in the Mission Impossible series. He's now in his 60s, and he was in his 50s when he was doing those movies. Denzel Washington did The Equalizer. It's a pretty good movie. Anyways, but to me, it started with this one, with Liam Neeson. And Liam Neeson was like an actor like I definitely respected, you know. Thought he was okay, but man, this movie made me a big Liam Neeson fan, where like anytime Liam Neeson's in a movie, I'm like, I'm gonna check it out just because of Liam Neeson. Even though now at this point, I'm getting kind of tired of Liam Neeson movies because they're all the same kind of action movies, and there's not a lot new in there. But man, when Taken came out, it was such a cool concept. I thought this ex-CIA guy whose daughter gets kidnapped in Paris, and he's like, he's the wrong father to mess with. I mean, if all the girls are kidnapped, this was not the girl to kidnap. Because now you got the most dangerous guy coming after your organization. And I just love his acting, and the action sequences, I think, are really well done. And I totally love the guy that goes, he pushes the limit of, you know, what a moral character would do. I mean, he does some immoral things, I would say, to get results. But I totally respect him for it, because he's like, ain't nothing matters except for getting my daughter back, and I'm gonna hurt innocent people. Even just I don't know something about that I kind of respect and like about the character, that he shows no mercy to anybody, and if you get in his way, you're in trouble anyways. But yeah, just a really great action movie. Started kind of this franchise that that I really enjoy at a point, you know. Anyway, so yeah, I'd love to see more of that. But yeah, Taken, great movie. Now I go to one of my favorite comedies of all time, Talladega Nights, The Ballad of Ricky Bobby. I mean, Will Ferrell was like he's at the peak of his career, I feel like, here, when he did Anchorman and this movie, or two of the funniest comedies ever. And Will Ferrell is one of my favorite comedians of all time, comedy actors. And it's another one where him and Andy, is it Andy? Adam McKay co-wrote the movie. Adam McKay directs it. I mean, it's such a great combination, those two together. Made some really good comedies. But yeah, him and John C. Reilly, it's such a great combo. Love to see them do more together, but really good cast overall. I mean, even you got I forget his name now, but Michael Clark Duncan there. I mean, the late Michael Clark Duncan's even funny in here. But yeah, just a silly comedy about a egotistical race car driver, but it has a pretty good story arc, you know, of him getting his downfall and coming back. And yeah, Amy Adams, one of my favorite actresses, is also in here. I mean, yeah, it's, I just died laughing when I saw this in the theater and still love watching it. And now we get to some childhood favorites of mine that I still really enjoy. And this is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, the original movie there. I remember seeing this in the theater. I think it's the first movie I ever saw in the movie theater. I believe back in 91 when I was maybe 8 years old or something like that. I kind of remember seeing this. I was obsessed with the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Of course, I watched the cartoon series. Absolutely loved the cartoon series. Loved playing the video games. But I had t-shirts. I had, you know, a watch that had like Michelangelo on it. So I had like, I had the figurines I played with. I mean, I had like all the merchandise, comic books. They were my favorite show for a while there when I was, you know, pretty young kid. And, I even dressed up as a Michelangelo for Halloween at one time. Anyway, so, but yeah, anyways, I love this movie. And even today when I watch it, it's one of those things where like I bought it for nostalgia reasons, but I still get a kick out of watching this. I actually kind of enjoy the costuming even more than the, like when they did the new Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles with Michael Bay kind of producing. I didn't like those because I didn't like the CGI turtles and they looked like really huge. And it was just, I don't know. I much prefer these costumed animatronic like costumes, with these actors doing the actions and stuff. I don't know. I really thought it got their personalities out just great. And what I love about these movies, I just love the personalities of the turtles, because they're teenagers. So they have this very, goofy side to them that I absolutely love, even when it's a serious moment. And some of the great, you know, catchphrases, you know, of, you know, I love being a turtle and cowabunga, and all that stuff. And so, yeah, it's still a very fun movie. Also, I got the second one, Turtles, the Secret of the Ooze, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2. Yeah, again, just like this first one, really great action comedy, I think, in here. I like the setting of the new sewer home that they create with the train subway in there. Also love the whole backstory of how they became turtles. It was this secret ooze from a secret organization, and how Shredder's trying to get that to make himself stronger. Yeah, I love the whole plot, and it's just, again, just a really fun movie. Even to this day, I have so much fun with those movies. Here's another one that actually was a childhood favorite of mine that I still love, is The Three Amigos. What a great trio. Some of the funniest, three of the funniest guys in the 80s, I would say, with Steve Martin, Chevy Chase, and Martin Short, all coming from Saturday Night Live. And I was a big Saturday Night Live guy at the time. But I used to love watching this as a kid. And it's still today, it's still a really fun comedy movie, of course, because the three together are just so funny. And I love the whole concept of three actors who think they're doing a performance but realize they're in a real situation with a real, you know, real kind of criminal, you know, organization in Mexico, and them trying to save this town even though they're just actors. They really don't know how to be heroes. And but yeah, it's such a great concept idea for a comedy, and the three work so well together. So many great moments. As a kid, I loved, there was a moment where they're just sitting there and they're singing the song, and the animals start singing along or something like that. The horses go boom, 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 boom. They start like singing along. And as a kid, that was like so funny, I guess. I know today I think it's kind of silly, but I still get so much fun out of watching those kind of scenes anyways. But yeah, I still think it's a really good movie to check out. The Three Amigos, really good comedy. And then go to a more serious film, one I used to grow up watching as well, To Kill a Mockingbird. with Gregory Peck there as Atticus Finch, or I think his name is. I mean, obviously, it's the classic novel. I had to read it when I was a freshman in high school. I feel like everybody had to read this novel, and it's a decent novel. But yeah, I remember watching this as a kid because my dad was a huge fan of this movie, of course, growing up. So I remember watching this kid. I remember being scared because the Boo Radley character, there's a moment where they think there's this guy next door who's a crazy, like, psycho killer. And, you know, the kids are just making stuff up. But they go over to touch the house, to kind of see if they can do it. And then they think they're being chased by the Boo Radley, and they're like having trouble and they're falling down. And of course, as a kid, you're thinking it's scary when you're watching other kids in trouble because you're a kid and you're thinking, oh my gosh, that would be a scary moment for me. And anyway, so I remember being scared more. And it wasn't until I was older, of course, that I realized the deeper meaning of the whole trial with the father played by Gregory Peck and, racism in the southern, town, and this guy's innocent, but there's this whole cover up and he's going to be guilty just because he's black. And that whole trial scene is just amazing. I absolutely love it. That's my favorite part of the movie now. As an adult, of course, is watching Atticus Finch kind of just tear apart the prosecutors, basically, but still lose because of racism. But the fact that he's willing to stand and fight a situation which he knows he's probably going to lose, but he's still going to stand up and fight for the innocent and for people that are being oppressed. And that's such a great moment. And Gregory Peck won Best Actor, of course, considered one of the great performances, his best performance of his career and what he's most well known for. But yeah, if you haven't seen it, definitely check it out. I mean, it's from the 60s, but I mean, great drama. It's so much stuff in this movie. The courtroom is just one part of it, but there's a lot of stuff that goes on with this movie, but it's a classic for sure. And I'm gonna go to one of my favorite franchises of all time, starting with Toy Story. I mean, what can you say? I watched this back in 95 when it came out in the theater. I was like 12 years old and absolutely loved it. I mean, first time seeing that kind of animation with the computer 3D animation kind of thing. And it just blew you away because all you've seen is 2D animation up to that point in a movie theater. And so you're like, wow, this is like, groundbreaking. But it was also a really fun story, great characters. Absolutely love the characters, of course, Woody and Buzz and everybody else. And it's funny, and there's actually some serious moments in there. And it's just absolutely amazing. One of the best anime movies ever made. And absolutely love all of them. I have all four, starting here with the second one. Probably my favorite out of the four. I mean, it's the funniest one, I think. And then it has this amazing song, When She Loved Me, which was nominated, should have won the Oscar probably. Makes you tear up when you hear that song. It's so beautiful by Sarah McLachlan singing that song. But yeah, and a really good story. I love it. Amazing sequel to a great story. Of course, this is probably a lot of people's favorite. It's actually probably my least favorite of the four, but yeah, it's still a really good movie. Toy Story 3, which we thought this was the end of the franchise. I think my only problem is that it feels like it repeats a lot of the same ideas from the second movie, and it's just not as funny as the other three, in my opinion. I don't laugh as much in the story. I'm not as big on the story, but obviously, it has a very emotional end to the movie, and that's what people kind of gravitate towards. But it's still a solid Toy Story movie. And then probably one I like more than everybody else is Toy Story 4, the last one. When they made this one, I was like, I was so surprised. I thought Toy Story 3 was a good ending to the series. It's like, wow, why do a fourth one? And there's always this fear, like, what if they make a fourth, a bad one? It could ruin the franchise or something. So I was kind of hesitant to watch this, in fact. But then when I did see it, I absolutely loved it. Still absolutely hilarious. I think, again, along with Toy Story 2, I think maybe the second funniest in the series. I laughed so much. I loved the new characters in it. And actually got really emotional at the end. And this definitely is the end of the franchise, I think. And so growing up from, 12-year-old in 1995 up to this one came out, I think, 2019, the last one. Now I'm in my, late 30s. So I'm going from 12 to like late 30s with this franchise. And so watching this fourth one just got me real emotional because I'm like, man, this is my childhood, these Toy Story movies. And now I'm watching it, you know, the last one, I'm watching them say goodbye, and it's like, oh, I'm saying goodbye to, you know, my childhood. Anyway, so yeah, absolutely love the Toy Story franchise. Next, get to the V's. I got Valkyrie, Tom Cruise movie, based on a true story of a real life individual who's was in Germany during World War II, was a captain or something. He was in the army, fairly high up, maybe colonel or something, Stauffenberg or something like that. And he helped plot assassination of Hitler, which is something I never knew about until this movie came out. I didn't realize there was almost assassination of Hitler, which really changed everything and ended the war early and would have been, you know, great. But yeah, really cool movie. I think it's underrated. I don't think, I feel like it got a lot of criticism because it takes place in Germany, but nobody speaks German. Everybody's speaking English and nobody has a German accent. They decided, Bryan Singer, who's the director, decided to just go, everybody just have their accents. So the English actors are speaking in English accents, and Tom Cruise, of course, has an American accent. But still, I think it's a really good story, a really cool part of history. And patriotism. I love the patriotism of, like, you know, German pride and knowing that, you know, Hitler is basically ruining Germany. And to get rid of Hitler would be good for Germany. So I love that patriotism idea of, like, this is what's best for our country, is getting rid of a maniac. Next, I'm getting to W's. I got WALL-E, a favorite Pixar movie of mine. It's like the best love story, and it's between two robots, and it's like I totally get the, you know, the relationship between the two. Or that I love that WALL-E's through the whole movie is just pining over this other robot, Eva. It's just a really cute movie, and that ending scene just gets me emotional. Like, I think it's such an amazing scene at the end, and WALL-E's such a fun character. It's such a great character. I love WALL-E, the character, even though he doesn't talk. And that's what's so amazing about the movie, is like he can only say like a couple words maybe, and yet you just absolutely fall in love with this robot, trash compactor robot thing. And even though I love the first like 15-20 minutes of the movie where it's just him going through garbage and you're kind of seeing how he lives his life and there's no dialogue, and it's like, wow, this is so fun and entertaining without any dialogue. I was actually really surprised. But yeah, a really great love story, comedy, WALL-E between two robots. All right, now we do probably the best zombie romantic comedy ever made, Warm Bodies. This is another one that really blew me away, based off of a book. Of course, zombies have become pretty popular, I think, because of Walking Dead is a huge TV show. And then Zombieland was another like comedy at the time that... I think, plus you got, I know all the serious, or you got Shaun of the Dead also, it was a very popular comedy. And so I kind of enjoy zombie movies after I started watching these, because I love the whole idea behind the zombie apocalypse idea and how do you survive. But this was such a unique story of a guy who's a zombie, but he doesn't remember his past life. But the whole movie is taking place in his point of view, and you can hear his thoughts, even though he's kind of this zombie that can't talk. He still has like intricate thoughts. And so we're getting everything through narration of him. And he meets this girl and he basically falls in love with her, even though he's a flesh-eating zombie. But something about her brings out humanity in him. And he starts changing from a zombie back into a human. I just love that concept, because usually zombies are just, you know, they're, once you're a zombie, you're dead. Basically, you're the undead. There's no going back. There's only, the only thing you do is kill you. So I love this. It's a really cool idea of like, okay, these people turn to zombies, but we can actually turn them back into humans and have a life again. And so there's something really cool about that whole concept. I love the whole romantic storyline between the two. It's a really funny movie and has such an amazing ending to it. Very heartwarming. And yeah, just a really, you don't get too many feel-good movies that are zombie movies. So I like that a lot. Next, I got a really great, underrated, I think, comedy, also pretty dramatic at times, The Way, Way Back. It came out maybe 5 years ago or so. It's just, it's a funny movie, but it's really kind of sad because this main character is, you know, with her mom and her mom's boyfriend. Her mom's boyfriend's a jerk to him, and they're in this area he doesn't know, and he's an introvert. And so I'm kind of introverted, so I kind of get this guy, and I feel sorry for this main character. And then he kind of opens up because he makes a friend with this guy named that played by Sam Rockwell, and he works at a water park. And he really is a guy that he can, you know, open up to and be friends with and share, you know, he's having all these troubles, and it just really helps this kid out. And so I just love that relationship between the two, Sam Rockwell's character and the main character, played by Liam James. I mean, such a heartwarming kind of, you know, a kid who needs a friend and finds it in this guy. And Sam Rockwell, best performance I think he's ever given. It's not maybe the Oscar-winning one, but he is absolutely hilarious. And he's such a, and he's a great guy. I just love the character because he's so nice and yet very funny and sarcastic. And he's the kind of guy I've met before that, you know, loves to kid around and stuff. And yeah, so it's a really good comedy, but also heartwarming too at the time and very emotional at times. Next I got a great parody, mockumentary called What We Do in the Shadows. Taika Waititi writing, directing this, and also starring in this movie. It's about vampires living in New Zealand, and it's a documentary style. So it's like they're talking to the camera, like we're getting an insight into how vampires live. And it's absolutely hilarious. That's all to say about it. I know Mike from Did You See That doesn't like the movie, but I think it's hilarious. Now we got to a Christmas classic, White Christmas, from the 50s, I believe. You got Bing Crosby and Danny Kaye, Rosemary Clooney, Vera Ellen, the main four there. Yeah, great musical. And I love the Christmas setting, of course. And White Christmas, one of the great songs of all time that they based it off of. And yeah, it's funny. The music sequences are amazing. The costuming, the set designs. It's everything that's great about 50s musicals, in my opinion. Then I got one of the great comedy musicals, I guess you can say, and one favorite Gene Wilder movie, probably. Well, it's in the top two for sure, but Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. Absolutely loved this movie as a kid and still love it today. It's such a fun movie. You got the Oompa Loompas on the back there. This is really cool. I love this Blu-ray I got of it, and there's like the inside of a chocolate thing. It's kind of like a book. It's got pictures of different people and tells a story, I think, of the movie. So it's really kind of a book kind of Blu-ray thing there I love. But what can I say? Love the music. Gene Wilder is absolutely hilarious. Such a great character. And again, just a really great feel-good ending to it. And so fun, the whole chocolate factory and all the different parts of it. Amazing set designs and just a lot of fun. Then next we got The Wizard of Oz. I mean, come on. One of the absolute great musical classics stories from 1939. Dorothy, who is from Kansas, which, so to me, this is like, if you're from Kansas, this is a must watch. I mean, every Kansan should have this movie, because of the relationship that she has with, you know, Kansas. What can you say? Great music, love the black and white to color, love all the costuming and set designs again, and just love the story. It's also funny, love the characters. The Scarecrow is always my favorite, but Scarecrow, Tin Pan, and the Cowardly Lion. I mean, such great characters. Great villain, the Wicked Witch of the East or West or whatever it was. And yeah, so much to say about that, but I need to go on. Then I got the X-Men, some X-Men movies. First one here. Definitely changed, I think, superhero movies, what you can do in them. This came out, I think, 99. I mean, this is before, you know, Spider-Man, it's for the Chris Nolan Batman, before the MCU. X-Men really changed things because you're like, wow, they really pushed the limits of what you can do with the technology, the CGI at the time, and make these really cool superhero characters come to life. And also introduced Hugh Jackman, one of the great actors, I think, the last 20 years, as Wolverine. Wolverine, one of the great superhero character, comic book superhero characters of all time. Got X-Men United. I think this is the best in the franchise. Love the story. And you got Patrick Stewart, Ian McKellen, Drew, what's her name? Halle Berry. I mean, so many, such a great cast. And then I don't have the third one. I don't like the third one. Third one I think is terrible. So I just skip. I go one, two, skip the third one, and I go the X-Men Days of Future Past, which I thought was such a great. I thought they made a lot of bad X-Men movies, in my opinion, and it was great when this came out because Bryan Singer came back to do this one. He did the first two, and then he took off, and he came back and did this one. So these are the three Bryan Singer X-Men movies. I think they're the best three in the series. And I love bringing back all the characters from the past and the new characters. And yeah, just another great story in the X-Men franchise, and really helps right a lot of the wrongs of the third movie. All right, next I got Yesterday, which as a Beatles fan, absolutely loved this movie, saw it in the movie theater. I hear so much criticism, but I don't get it. I just love the idea of this guy. No one knows who the Beatles are except for this one guy, and he brings Beatles music back, and he becomes the most popular musician of all time, or is, you know, he's becomes a sensation because the Beatles music is always going to be good no matter what decade you're playing the music in my opinion. The Beatles are always going to be the greatest. Whether you hear it back in the 60s or you hear it today, no one matches the Beatles, in my opinion. So I just love the whole idea of showcasing how great the Beatles are. And yeah, it's a nice little romantic comedy and absolutely amazing music in it. Now we've got probably my favorite comedy of all time, and another Gene Wilder, great, and Mel Brooks, great, Young Frankenstein. I mean, the best parody film ever made, parodying the old Frankenstein movies. And yeah, so many great moments. Gene Wilder is absolutely amazing in it. Absolutely must watch. I think came from the 70s period. If you hadn't watched that, definitely watch Young Frankenstein, one of the great comedies. And then I'm going to end the series on Z. The only Z movie I have is Zombieland, which I mentioned before. Really got me into the zombie franchise, really, because I wasn't really into zombies. I'm not a horror guy, but I thought this looked like a fun movie. So when I watched it, I absolutely loved it. It's a really funny movie dealing with an interesting take on the zombie genre. And Woody Harrelson, absolutely amazing. Love his character. So funny. And really great cast. I mean, you got Emma Stone in there, Jesse Eisenberg, Abby Breslin in there. I always get her name wrong. But I don't see it here. Anyways, yeah, it's a great zombie comedy, which I love. I'm kind of into zombie comedies with Warm Bodies and Zombieland. And I like The Walking Dead. So I've really gotten into zombie movies because of that. And yeah, it's just a really fun movie. And still good practical effects, I think. The zombies look pretty good. But yeah, it's just a fun movie. So yeah, I had to get that one. Anyway, so that's the end of all my Blu-rays and DVDs. I hope you enjoyed watching and me sharing my thoughts on some of my favorite movies I've gotten so far. I have many more to buy and to showcase on here. So it's definitely not the end, but it's what I've got. And I said, I only got like 170 movies. So not as much as some people who have thousands of Blu-rays and DVDs. I got 170, which is okay for me. And I'll get some more. So anyways, so yeah, feel free to comment what you thought about the movies I owned or what I showcased here. Love to read them. And just thank you to anybody watching this. Thank you for liking the video. And thank you to all my subscribers for supporting the channel. I appreciate you all. I hope you have a good day.